له الفداء كل وليك الحجة ابن الحسن صلواتك عليه وعلى آبائه في هذه الساعة وفي كل ساعة وليا وحافظا وقائدا وناصرا ودليلا وعينا حتى تسكنه أرضك طوعا وتمتعه فيها طويلا. قال الله الحكيم في محكم كتابه الكريم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم ألهاكم التكاثر حتى زرتم المقابر كلا سوف تعلمون ثم كلا سوف تعلمون كلا لو تعلمون علم اليقين لترون الجحيم ثم لترونها عين اليقين ثم لتسألن يومئذ عن النعيم. آمنا بالله صدق الله العلي العظيم. اللهم صل على محمد وعلى آله. Dear مؤمنين مؤمنات, brothers and sisters, السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. Congratulations on the birthday anniversary of the Master of the Apostles, the Master of the Messengers, in fact, the Master of all beings that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created and without whom He would not have created, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad. On this auspicious occasion, we offer first and foremost our congratulations to the Imam of our time, Ajallallah Ta'ala Farajahu Sharif. And we pray to Allah Subhanahu Wa Ta'ala to be amongst the sincere lovers of Rasulullah and lovers of his purified progeny and sincere lovers and followers of our Imam, Ajallallah Ta'ala Farajahu Sharif. The ayat that I recited from Surat At-Takathur, in fact, very powerful ayat reminding us of Akhirah and the journey that we'll all go through. Every single one of us will go through that journey, the journey after death. It starts with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala saying that you got so busy increasing. Al-haakum al-takathur. It preoccupied you from what you should be doing. And I'm paraphrasing slightly, not translating directly. Hatta zurtumul maqabir. Until, or one of the mufassirin or one of the tafasir is that you even went as far as, however, we'll go with the basic and the most common one, which is until you visited the maqabir, the graveyards, cemeteries. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala declares, and this declaration starts with kalla. And this kalla is not to say no, it is actually almost like an exclamation mark, a very powerful exclamation mark. You know, when you put that big exclamation mark, like, pay attention, pay notice to what is to be said, then the next part is, كَلَّا سَوْفَ تَعْلَمُونَ, for sure you will know. ثُمَّ كَلَّا, again another big exclamation mark. Big notice, pay attention, you will know then. ثُمَّ كَلَّا سَوْفَ تَعْلَمُونَ. Then eventually the ayat come to the what is to be known and what is to be noticed. كلا لو تعلمون علم اليقين لترون الجحيم. If you had the knowledge of certainty or the certain knowledge, then you would see with your own eyes the consequences of actions. لَتَرَوُنَّ الْجَحِيمِ. You would see, Jahim is the fire, the very lit up and very burning, scorching fire. However, that Jahim is in fact the consequence of our actions. In other words, if God forbid one is doing something that leads to hellfire, he would see it here. And this is how, in fact, Ahlul Bayt, salawatullah wa salamu alayhim, they saw things in this world. Therefore, they could never, in fact, there is a narration that somebody asked one of the Imams of Ahlul Bayt that, are you able to commit a sin? Can you commit it? Then the Imam, according to some narrations, he brought him something rotten, completely rotten from the garbage or something. He said, are you able to eat that? Of course not. He says, this is how we see things. We see it for what it really is. Therefore, we cannot go near it. A sin to us is its real thing. We see it. We see the sin for its reality. We can never commit it. لَتَرَوُنَّ الْجَحِيمِ ثُمَّ لَتَرَوُنَّهَا. And then you will see it. Then you will see it. عَيْنَ الْيَقِينَ ثُمَّ لَتَرَوُنَّهَا. عَيْنَ الْيَقِينَ ثُمَّ لَتُسْأَلُنَّ يَوْمَئِذٍ عَنِ النَّعِيمِ. Then you will be asked about the na'im. What is this na'im? And this is what I want to discuss mostly tonight. The na'im. Then you will be asked about the na'im. ثُمَّ لَتُسْأَلُنَّ. For sure, definitely, this تُسْأَلُنَّ has a lot of emphasis in it, that term. ثُمَّ لَتُسْأَلُنَّ يَوْمَئِذٍ. On that day, you will be asked about the na'im. So what is this na'im? You will definitely be asked about the na'im. Na'im, translated typically as blessings. But what are these blessings that we will be asked about? In the tafasir of Ahlul Bayt, salawatullah wa salamu alayhim, and I'll narrate a story. A man came to the house of Imam Al-Baqir alayhi salam. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad. He narrates, he says, I came to the house of Imam Abu Ja'far, referring to him, Al-Imam Al-Baqir alayhi salam, and he said, I was offered food. The man, his name is Abi Khalid Al-Kabuli. He says, I came to the house of Imam Baqir alayhi salam, and I was offered food. I ate from that food. And the Imam ate, we finished. When we finished, the Imam asked me, he said, how was our food? He said, I've never tasted something as delicious and as good smelling as this food. You know, food, we taste it with our smelling and with our tongue, yeah? He says, I never ever had food as delicious and as good smelling as this food, never. However, the man says, but I remember the ayah in the Holy Quran in Surah At-Takathur when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, ثُمَّ لَتُسْأَلُنَّ يَوْمَئِذٍ عَنِ النَّعِيمِ, that I will be asked about the na'im, na'im, blessings. He says, I remember that ayah from the Holy Quran. In other words, he's trying to clarify. Hopefully he's not trying to outsmart. We'll give him the benefit of the doubt and say he was trying to clarify. What is na'im? He thought in his mind, he's saying, Ibn Rasulullah, I thought this is na'im, and I thought we should not be after delicious food and good food in this dunya because we will be asked about it on the day of judgment. So the Imam says to him, this is not what you understand. It is definitely not. In so many different narrations about the same topic, in fact, in different words. In one of them he says, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is more generous than to give good food to his servants and come and ask them about it. أَكْرَمُ مِنْ أَنْ He is more honorable. Don't even think that he could ask and question you about good food that he's offered you. He told you about it. He taught you how to make that good food. He guided you how to plant those trees and fruit plants and so on. He even talks about it in his Quran, saying that he has given you mushtabihan wa ghayra mutashabih, so many different fruits with different colors looking alike, but they're not the same. So many ayat about the na'im that he has given you. Now he is going to ask you about it on the Day of Judgment. How can you understand it in this way? So he said, then what is the na'im, Ibn Rasulullah? He says, na'im is wilayatuna ahlul bayt. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. Na'im is to, in one narration, is na'im is Rasulullah and his progeny, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad wa ahlu baytih. This is the na'im. Unfortunately, nowadays you have the enemies of Ahlul Bayt, the Takfiri Wahhabi school, who attack the followers of Ahlul Bayt for quoting such a hadith. Because they take things on the surface and they call the people who say this hadith, they call us, in fact, they call us liars and kuffar. Because they say the Quran says Na'im, and these people make up things that it is Ahlul Bayt. So they see it as on the surface, they see it basically Na'im is food and drink, so they would rather, wal'ayadu billah, and that's why I often say we have a different God, we have a different prophet. I'll come to the prophet part as well, inshallah. The different God, they would rather a God that is not generous, a God that is not honorable, wal'ayadu billah, that is their God. A God that gives you the ni'mah and then questions you about it. Gives you the food and drink, basic necessities of life. It's like a father giving food to his children and coming and telling them, you know, I am feeding you. What are you doing eating my food? Giving mennat. Like I'm doing you a favor, I'm feeding you. Is this a favor that a father does to his children? Or is that his duty? Or are we lost? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives us all these beautiful things. And he wants to... That is not the way we should understand him. Rather, the higher, the bigger ni'mah, the one that is not necessity of life in this world, in the physical world, rather a necessity of the real life, the spiritual life. You want Quranic proof? If any of those people wants to question you, you want Quranic proof? Let us read the Quran. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the surah that we have to recite in salat every day, wajib, Surah Al-Hamd, Al-Fatiha, Al-Sab'u Al-Mathani. He says, اِهْدِنَا الصِّرَاطَ الْمُسْتَقِيمِ Guide us to the right path. Simple translation. صَرَاطَ الَّذِينَ أَنْعَمْتَ عَلَيْهِمْ The path of those whom you have bestowed your blessings upon. نعمة. أَنْعَمْتَ نعمة. Therefore, we have to look at those who are richer and eat better food and follow their path. Yeah? Is that what it means? So I have to look at who has a nicer food, where they give better food. Perhaps like some people in the month of Ramadan, which center do I go to break my fast? Let me see what's on the menu. Maybe. Or, you know, some invitations, you know, you have different invitations. Let me accept the invitation based on the food that they're giving. Now, invitation for the stomach, that's okay. I don't think that's a problem, yeah? Is it? It's not a problem. But invitation about the path that leads to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala based on what food? That is a problem. That I'm going to look at people who has more wealth and better food and better blessings in that regard and follow them. Because the ayah says, صَرَاطَ الَّذِينَ أَنْعَمْتَ عَلَيْهِمْ Those you have, whom you have given them blessings, bestowed your blessings upon them. So what is the na'mah here? Quran translates and explains itself. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in another ayah of the Holy Quran introduces those whom He has bestowed His mercy upon. When He says, those who obey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the Messenger, فَمَنْ يُطَعِ اللَّهَ وَرَسُولَهُ فَأُولَٰئِكَ مَعَ الَّذِينَ أَنْعَمَ اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِمْ They are with those whom God has given them that those blessings and mercy. Who are they? مِنَ النَّبِيِّينَ وَالصِّدِّيقِينَ وَالشُّهَدَاءِ وَالصَّالِحِينَ They have received the blessings from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Who are they? نبيين, صديقين, شهداء. Now do you feel it's weird to say that ثُمَّ لَتُسْأَلُنَّ يَوْمَئِذٍ عَنِ النَّعِيمِ Those na'im, is it now weird or odd to say that it's Ahlul Bayt, the Prophet and his progeny? Or is it what it should be? Now it's very obvious. If Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling us to ask Him, to pray to Him and ask Him, اهدنا الصراط المستقيم صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم and he is introducing the ones whom he has bestowed his blessings upon calling saying who are they نبيين the prophets صديقين شهداء and صالحين the prophets their successors those who testified to their message the martyrs and the righteous ones these are the ones with blessings not the ones who have basic food and material things of this dunya. This is not the real ni'mah. The real ni'mah is in fact guidance from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala through Ahlul Bayt salawatullah wa salamu alayhim. That is why when it comes to the ikmalun ni'mah or ikmalul deen wa itmamun ni'mah, we say praise belongs to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that He has made the completion of the religion and the perfection of his blessings through the wilaya of Amirul Mu'mineen salawatullah wa salamu alayhi. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad. Why? Because the ayah in Surah Al-Ma'idah, and again, there are some who like to take the ayah on a surface level. They say the ayah came in the context of food, in the surah of food, surah of Ma'idah, and in the context of food, what God has made haram and what God has made halal. And therefore this ni'mah is the basic food. Subhanallah. When the ayah says, Al-yawma akmaltu lakum ni'mati wa akmaltu lakum deenakum wa atmamtu alaykum ni'mati wa raditu lakum al-islam deena. The religion is completed through Rasulullah with the wilaya of Amirul Mu'mineen salawatullah wa salamu alayhi. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad. This is the real ni'mah. So what is the questioning about that ni'mah? ثُمَّ لَتُسْأَلُنَّ يَوْمَئِذٍ عَنِ النَّعِيمِ What is the questioning about the ni'mah? Questioning about the ni'mah, whether I know the names of these blessings, whether I come and gather on the birthday of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam and celebrate, or come on the days of their martyrdom and their grieve and sit and mourn? Is that what I will be questioned about? Or is it something else? I want us to pay attention here, because we gather based on their order. They ordered us to gather. The Prophet and his progeny ordered us to gather and to narrate hadith. These gatherings are blessed, loved by the Prophet and his progeny. But they are purposeful. They're not the end goal. They're not the end, rather the means to an end. They are not the ghaya, they are the wasila, as we call it, these gatherings. So what is the end that we are meant to receive through these gatherings? It is to learn the teachings of Ahlul Bayt salawatullah wa salam alayhim. It is to be able to follow their path. This is the real ni'mah that we will be asked about. That on the Day of Judgment, you and I will be asked about, we gave you the best example. وَلَكُمْ فِي رَسُولِ اللَّهِ أُسْوَةٌ لَقَدْ كَانَ لَكُمْ فِي رَسُولِ اللَّهِ أُسْوَةٌ حَسَنَةٌ. Indeed, through the Messenger of God, there is the best example for you. For who? Everyone know, لِمَنْ كَانَ يَرْجُ اللَّهَ وَالْيَوْمَ الْآخِرَةِ. Those who believe in God and hope in meeting their Lord and the Day of Judgment, they believe in it and hope that they would meet their Lord on the Day of Judgment. For those people, the best example is Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And that is what we will be asked about. That we gave you this example. He walked on earth like you walk on earth. And he lived his life like an average person, marrying, having children, and so on, in the physical, material sense. However, his life was an example of a perfect human being that we should achieve and we should strive towards. And this is what we'll be asked about. We will be asked about whether or not we followed his teachings in that regard. And I want to give some examples. In fact, this is something that came to my mind recently, maybe today or very recently. I was just changing lanes, you know, in a highway, a few lanes, changing lanes. And sometimes you have people who, as soon as they see you indicate, they don't want to let you in. Yeah? It's like some sort of a, we say maraz. Yeah. Some sort of a disease. Okay. What is the problem? I mean, you're not going to get to your destination any earlier. And someone wants to change lanes. Now he's trying to, you know, whatever your assumptions are, maybe they're in the wrong lane by mistake, whatever it may be. Maybe they don't know their way. Suddenly they realize they have to be in this lane. Why do we have to be mean? Huh? Why do we have to? Even if they are not doing the best thing, even if they should have been in their lane from the beginning, why do you have? Immediately came to my mind that if we lived, all of us, if we all lived like the Prophet and his progeny in everything that we do in life, just think about it. Imagine the Prophet ﷺ is sitting behind the wheel. How would he drive? Now he's not around us. But imagine a righteous person, not the Prophet, a righteous, how would he drive? If everybody drove like that, wouldn't we live in a perfect society on perfect roads? Think about it. Absolutely no road rage. Everything goes smoothly. Yeah? Uswatun hasanatun. Beautiful. Now apply that to everything in life. A husband, how he would treat his wife. A wife, how she would treat her husband. A father to the children. Children to their parents. A neighbor. In everything, look at the example of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. We have examples how he dealt with people. When he was treated well and when he was mistreated, how he dealt with people. If everybody makes sure that this is how I want to live my life in every day-to-day transaction, we would live in a perfect world. Literally, perfect world. And we should not wait for others, because others may not have the exposure to the na'im. This is the na'im we have. ثُمَّ لَتُسْأَلُنَّ يَوْمَئِذٍ عَنِ النَّعِيمِ. If I receive the na'im, alhamdulillah, we have our children, and you grew up as most of us, we grew up as children, fed the love of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and his progeny. Huh? We were fed that love, not just with the spoon, but with the milk. You know, there's a beautiful poem in Arabic. He says, may God not punish my mother. She fed me the love of the wasi. You know, the Saddiq, the wasi, Amirul Mu'mineen, salawatullah wa salamu alayhi. She fed that to me through the milk. And my father loved Abu Hassan. He loved Imam Ali alayhi salam. فَصَرْتُ مِنْ ذِي وَذَا أَهْوَى أَبَا حَسَنٍ. Through him and through her, I became a lover of Imam Amirul Mu'mineen. We are lovers of Ahlul Bayt, most of us, through the parents that we have, alhamdulillah. So we have that ni'mah accessible to us. Many people don't have that. Many people don't have the example of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. We have him. We will be asked about it. I have the choice. I can make that choice. I want to live like Rasulullah, or I want to ignore that and live by the example of, God forbid, shayateen, the devils, the whispering of the shayateen. No. The ni'mah that we will be asked about on the day of judgment, in fact, is how we followed Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam and how we followed him, and not the image that is distorted. Inshallah, if we have the chance in the future, I want to cover, but not as we celebrate his birthday, in the future, cover some of the controversies and distorted images that they have depicted of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, whether in the books of the enemies of Rasulullah through Bani Umayyah and Bani al-Abbas, that they fabricated narrations, and or whether through other books and accusations, his marriages, his perhaps relationship with his wives and so on. Many of those controversies that we need to address, in fact, otherwise we would be like those who draw an image of somebody who is not nowhere near a perfect human being, nowhere near a role model for humanity, uswatun hasanatun. And inshallah, I want to address that, because it has become very common that people misunderstand some of the basic principles of a prophet, and therefore some of those stories are okay, including, you know, the story of Abasa wa Tawalla and the rest of it. Inshallah, we'll cover them in the future. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us amongst the sincere lovers and followers of the prophet and his progeny, those who are happy during their happy occasions and saddened by their sadness. Before I conclude with the dua, I just wanted to see if there are any questions that I could answer. Otherwise, we'll conclude, inshallah, with dua. Yes. Okay. Yeah. When we recite Quran or Fatiha or Ayat al-Kursi, do we have to have wudu? It is recommended to have wudu when we recite Quran, but it's not wajib. You can recite Quran without wudu, but you cannot touch Quran without wudu. You cannot touch the words of the Holy Quran without wudu, but you can recite. It is recommended to recite on wudu, but it's not mandatory. You can recite. Inshallah, if there are no questions, we'll conclude, inshallah, with the recitation of Surah Al-Mubarakat Al-Fatiha for all the marhumin, our marhumin, your marhumin, masbuqatan bis salati ala Muhammadin wa ali Muhammad. Allahumma salli ala Muhammadin wa ali Muhammad. Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Alhamdulillahi rabbil alamin.
Inshallah, we will end with the ziyarat of Rasulullah.
اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد
اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم السلام عليك يا بنت السلام عليك يا رسول الله السلام عليك يا نبي الله السلام عليك يا محمد بن عبد الله السلام عليك يا خاتم النبيين أشهد أنك قد بلغت الرسالة وأقمت الصلاة وآتيت الزكاة وأمرت بالمعروف ونهيت عن المنكر وعبدت الله مخلصا حتى أتاك اليقين وصلوات الله عليك ورحمته وعلى أهل بيتك الطاهرين أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمداً عبده ورسوله وأشهد أنك رسول الله وأنك محمد بن عبد الله وأشهد أنك قد بلغت رسالات ربك ونصحت لأمتك وجاهدت في سبيل الله وعبدت الله حتى أتاك اليقين بالحكمة والموعظة الحسنة وأديت الذي عليك من الحق وأنك قد رؤوفت بالمؤمنين وقلظت على الكافرين فبلغ الله بك أفضل شرف محله المكرمين الحمد لله الذي استنقذنا بك من الشرك والضلال اللهم فاجعل صلواتك وصلوات ملائكتك المقربين وأنبيائك المرسلين وعبادك الصالحين وأهل السماوات والأرضين ومن سبح لك يا رب العالمين من الأولين والآخرين على محمد عبدك ورسولك ونبيك وأمينك ونجيك وحبيبك وصفيك وخاصتك وصفوتك وخيرتك من خلقك اللهم أعطه الدرجة الرفيعة وآته الوسيلة من الجنة وابعثه مقام المحمودة يغبطه به الأولون والآخرون اللهم إنك قلت ولو أنهم إذ ظلموا أنفسهم جاءوك فاستغفروا الله واستغفر لهم الرسول لوجدوا الله توابا رحيما وإني أتيتك مستغفرا تائبا من ذنوبي وإني أتوجه بك إلى الله ربي وربك ليغفر لي ذنوبي صلوات